10 years ago, I had the worst insomnia. I was working full time. I was doing grad school at night. If you've ever been in that situation, my heart goes out to you. It's a rough chapter of life to be in. And the way that my stress came out was I stopped sleeping. I would just be up for what felt like all night. And after a while, I would get tired of laying in bed. This was at the very beginning of social media apps. So there was like, I don't even know if I had a smartphone then. There was no like phone to scroll through for hours. So what I would do is I would get out of bed and I would make YouTube videos. So if you look back at my earliest videos, 2011 or 2012, they were almost all filmed in the middle of the night, thanks to grad school stress insomnia. So for me, in my brain, I have being up in the middle of the night and making YouTube videos, they're very intertwined in my brain. So today, guess what? I'm up in the middle of the night. Well, practically, it's five now, but I woke up at three, not for insomnia. Thank goodness, those terrible sleeping days are behind me, but I woke up to speak at a conference, the Present to Succeed conference, which is organized by Europeans, typically attended by Europeans. So they have a very, very different time zones, right? From little American Anne. So they're, what time was it for them? I don't know. It was their regular morning, but it was my like wee hours of the morning. Anyway, I've been up for a while and I wanted that presentation. I thought was really cool. I thought it was really cool about a really cool topic. And I want to share a segment with you. I'm up anyway. Why not help benefit more people, share the Dataviz love a little bit more? So let's see. Let's see if my 5 a.m. brain can do this, okay? You be the judge. Let's hope. So in that talk, I was talking about how to present dense Dataviz without losing your audience. And I started by saying like, hey, I'm Anne. I work with all these different types of groups, government agencies, universities, foundations, for-profits, hospitals, a little bit of everybody. And what these groups have in common is they want to soar beyond the dusty shelf report. They want to move beyond that typewriter style academic report and transition into highly visual, engaging, memorable, useful reports. And they also want to avoid death by PowerPoint. They want to be able to explain really dense graphs in a way that their audience can actually understand, that their audience is paying attention to make it more likely that people use that data for future decision making. So in the presentation, we went through seven examples, and I'm going to show you one, okay? One of the ones that it's a personal favorite, so I hope you like this one too. I want to show you first how you'd edit this graph, which is not terrible. It's not like overly dense. It's just a regular old bar chart. You've seen these a million times, right? But I want to show you how we could take this to the next level and edit this. That's first. And then second, I'm going to show you how you would storyboard it, as I call it, how you would break up the content over multiple slides so that what we're talking about is what people are seeing. We want that cohesion across all the senses. And then third, I'm going to go behind the scenes with you and show you how to do this, because you can use animation, I think. Maybe. I'm not a fan of PowerPoint's animation. I'm going to show you what I do instead. And you can laugh at how unfancy and a little clunky, it's not sexy. It's not sexy behind the scenes. So I'm going to show you behind the scenes, okay? So we'll edit this one. We're going to storyboard it or break it up over multiple slides. And then I'll show you some practical tech how-tos. Okay, let's do it. So first up, this graph. It's not terrible, but it could be better. This is a real graph. Kind of. These aren't the real states or the real numbers, but it's based loosely on a project where they were monitoring how states were doing, and we wanted all the states to reach this magical target, okay? If there is a target in your project, please show that on the graph. Don't just say that with your voice, like show it during the presentation. Another thing that I'd want to do to this graph is to group the states, groups that met or exceeded the target and those that didn't. You know me, I'm a fan of everyday software. This is just an Excel graph pasted into PowerPoint. So my graph in Excel you know how there's like a table, right? You set up the table, then you set up the graph. I just added a gap to the table, which produces a gap in the graph. So imagine, picture your table, right? You've got some rows and columns and cells in there. You just insert a blank row. That's it. You insert a blank row, and then you get a blank row on your graph for that grouping, right? For categorization, to help people understand and make sense of the information. Let's keep going with grouping. I would also want to apply some dark light contrast to make one bucket stand out over another. I'm not a fan of Debbie Downer neon red. I'm not a fan of like green is good and red is bad. I don't want to like make these people feel terrible with this kind of shaming tone of the presentation. So I didn't use red here. I'm not a fan of Debbie Downer red. I use blue with gray. Let's keep going with the categorization. I would also want to add some words to help people really see those categories. And I might quantify them a little bit more. I would probably say this in the talk anyway. I'd probably be like, 6 states met or exceeded the target. We'll like put some of those keywords on the graph, right? Here's one more edit that I would want to do to this graph. I would want to add icons, because there's research showing that icons make our graphs more memorable. Even simple stuff, even the checks, even the X's, these are going to be helpful and memorable. These are bare minimum edits. These are things we need to be doing all the time. I wish all of us did this all the time. I wish my past self did this all the time. Adding target lines, if that applies to your project. Adding visual grouping, visual spacing. Also grouping with color, like blue versus gray, using less Debbie Downer red in our grouping. Adding some words like met or exceeded. Adding some icons like checks and X's. We have to do this. We have to do this anyway to avoid death by PowerPoint. Once you have this, okay, like we've done the first thing, we've edited the graph. Let's storyboard it or break it up over multiple slides. I'm going to turn on my fake presentation voice, and I'm going to show you how you could talk about this graph. So you might say, okay, and next up in our presentation, we're going to talk about the states reaching our year-end targets. As you know, we score our states using our rating system, and we score them from 0 to 100, and our target is 40. That's the number that we want all these states in our project to hit by the end of the year. So let's see how our states are doing so far. There's some good news here. 6 of our states have already met or exceeded the target. Virginia's scoring the highest so far. They've reached 95 out of 100. Maryland is also scoring high. New York, New Jersey, South Dakota, Montana. Montana's right at that 40 mark. We're going to count them. We're really just looking at 40 or higher. And not every state has hit the target yet, though. There are 3 that are still below. We still have time left before the end of the year, though. So what we really want to do is focus on Oregon and Minnesota and Ohio, and make sure that we do everything we can with those project managers to boost them up to that 40 level. You may end by talking about, you know, some actionable next steps there, okay? It's 4 slides. Sure, you could do this with animation. That's probably possible. If you want to use animation, go for it. You're going to get the same end result. I like using separate slides, okay? You make the final slide, the edited slide, because you've got to do it anyway, and then you spend like 5 more minutes. Okay, I'm not asking you to stay up all night, because that's miserable. I'm just asking you to spend about 5 minutes breaking it up over multiple slides. So what you say is a match with what people are seeing. We want that cohesion across the senses. Okay, we edited it. I showed you how you'd storyboard it. The third and final thing I promised you is I want to take you behind the scenes and show you how to do this. Okay, so this is multiple slides, right? There's this one, this one, this one, this one. And I like doing that because I like going to the slide sorter view, this one that shows you the slides at a glance. And it just helps me prep. I like prepping and being like, okay, first I'm gonna talk about this. Oh yeah, that's right, I remember. Okay, and then I'm gonna talk about this next. And then, okay, I'll talk about the blue sections, those states, then I'll talk about gray. It just helps me. It's very selfish. It helps me be a more prepared presenter so I know what's coming next. I feel like with animation, with all these, it's still one slide and it, I don't know. I'm just not a fan of it. I'm not a fan of it. If you are, go for it. You're going to get the same end result. So let me show you how to make this, okay? What you do is you make the final slide. This is the final edited slide. And then you copy and paste. So I'm going to click on the little slide picture on the left, copy it, Control C. And then I'm just going to paste it, Control V. And then you delete or hide one thing. So if the final slide has everything, right? The green, excuse, not green. That's my 5 a.m. brain. It has the blue. It has the gray. Then this one's going to have one less thing. It's not going to have the gray. So I'm going to delete this. These are just regular icons. Insert icon. Delete that. This is just a text box. I'm going to delete that. You cannot delete this part. You can see this is one graph, right? I told you I added a gap in the table in Excel. I pasted that into PowerPoint. It's one graph. So if you click on this and delete it, that doesn't work. So we can't just delete those. What I'm going to do, this is the not so fancy part. I'm going to just cover these up and make them invisible, not with brand purple, but with white, and make sure it doesn't have an outline. It's like you know it's there, right? Because you're in the know now, and I know it's there, but our audience doesn't know that there's a white text box sitting on the screen. With these bars, I can't delete them because you know what's going to happen. You know, right? The whole, those don't get deleted. But I can click on one bar at a time and right click and adjust the fill to make them invisible. In this graph, I wanted to have some light gray grid lines. So you are not going to do a white fill because look what the white fill does. Can you see it? It covers up the gray grid line. So I typically do a no fill. Right click, fill button, no fill. That's the clear or transparent version. Yes, it takes a moment to click on three whole bars and change the color one at a time, but it takes this long, okay? I'm not asking you to stay up all night. I'm not asking you to work nights and weekends. I'm asking you to spend about 5 minutes doing this for some of your dense graphs. Okay, a couple more things. Let's just delete one label at a time. I think that's it, right? That's the last slide in the sequence. That's the second to last. Okay. Copy, Control C, click right above it, Control V, and delete one more thing. And that's going to be this top part. I could either just make my white text box bigger or delete these. Can I delete them? No, I can't delete them. I don't think I can delete these. I was thinking, now I can delete. No, because it's going to stretch the bars out wider. Yeah, I'm going to do the white text box to cover them up. Make sure it's wide enough. I can make all of these transparent now, and I can delete all these labels. Last, second to last. That's the next one. Okay, copy, paste, and then... Oh, I know you're rolling your eyes at how fancy I was. Look, I just did the line. I did the line technique. I know you know there are fancier ways to do this with combo charts. I know fancier ways of doing this, but honestly, sometimes just adding the good old line. I hate that I'm showing you this. It's just this. It's just the line, okay? It's the line. I'm just going to delete that. Oh, wait till you see that. You're gonna unsubscribe. I know. Oh, this is just a text box. I didn't even do any fancy access titles here, and you're gonna hate this. That's a text box, okay? That's a text box. Because you cannot make one in Excel and PowerPoint. You cannot just make one of these bold and an accent color. You can only do all of them or none of them, right? Like if you try to click on this one, you can make them all blue, but we don't need that, okay? We just need one blue so that it stands out. It's supposed to stand out with color contrast against the rest of them. So what I typically do is I make my text box a no fill, and then I position it ever so carefully. This is terrible. Why am I showing you this? This is terrible. I position it ever so carefully on top of the existing label. And then when it's positioned, I fill it in white. Got it? I use the transparency, the no fill, just for a minute so I can make sure it's not off, that it's not like kittywampus. And then I do a white fill. Okay. Okay. So first this, and then this, then this, then this. If you want to do animation to make white text boxes appear, I don't know if animation can make, I don't know if it can color, but maybe it can. I don't know. I'm not a fan of it. I'm not a fan of it because, like I mentioned, I like going to the slide sorter view for me behind the scenes and saying, okay, this and then this. It helps me prep. It helps me prep a lot better. Okay. What do you think? What do you think? You don't have to do this all the time. I use it in two key places in my presentations, to start with a bang, to let people know this presentation is not going to be death by PowerPoint. It's going to be engaging. It's going to be quick paced. I usually do it for the first graph in my presentation. Let's say you have like 10 graphs you're presenting at your meeting. The first graph is a nice use of your time. Spend about 5 minutes extra on that one. And then I also use it to explain dense data, data with things like target lines and groupings and cutoff points, and maybe where you want to have some color coding to walk it through one piece at a time. If or when you use this approach, get in touch. Get in touch so I can celebrate all of your hard work. All right, that's it for now. Back to sleep for me, I think.